So today I'm going to show you some examples of the work I did in the process of creating the score for Mission Impossible. And we're just in my writing room in Los Angeles here. But it's a pretty similar layout to what I had when I wrote the score in London. I keep a template that I first built when I first used the Vienna Symphonic Library. And I keep tweaking it through project after project after project so that my levels are worked out. By the time I did Mission, this was maybe the 15th project I'd done with this template. So I was able to have everything kind of worked out to plug in, plug and play, get up and go. On my main rig, I'm now using MirX with the pre-programmed presets for different halls and also different chair placements within the hall virtually. But this one, in fact, I don't think MirX, I know MirX wasn't even out yet when I did Mission Impossible. And I was just using a Lexicon plugin reverb, which I was happy with. Again, the most important, the most critical thing in these mockups was to show the director give him an accurate idea of what to expect when we got to the recording studio and had the live orchestra playing it. When I was a student in music school, one of my teachers was a very big fan of doing as much writing in your head as possible and not necessarily having it tied into any specific instrument. His argument was that people who write only on the piano sort of write music that sounds like piano music, and people who write on guitar write guitar music. So I do try to think orchestrally from the very beginning. Then when it comes time to do the actual scoring to picture, I do that all within Cakewalk, all within Sonar, and I do it all to picture. I map out all my tempos and all my sync points within the sequence, and I do it all virtually, digitally, in the sequencer environment. There just isn't time anymore to do it all on pencil and paper with beat sync or a click book or anything like that. And I learned all that stuff as a student in music school, and, you know, I would be able to do it if I had to, but it's just become the workflow. For one thing, doing all the work on paper makes it more time-consuming to get it all orchestrated, because the majority of orchestration work happens in Finale or Sibelius now. It's much more efficient to have the music delivered to the orchestrators as a MIDI sequence than it is to have it delivered on pencil and paper. When it came to the specifics of scoring Mission Impossible, the first thing I did was do some very early sketch work for the opening sequence with the airplane, the A400. And it was as I was sort of developing that compositionally that I stumbled on this idea that I would try to write the score for this film as if I was scoring the pilot of the original TV show. In the sense that I didn't want to use any instruments or sounds that Lalo Schifrin couldn't have achieved in 1966 when he created the pilot, which meant in the finished actual score, I didn't want any sort of electric guitars or, you know, electric bass or a drum kit. Now, those things were available to him, but not in the sort of sound and fidelity that we have today. And I really didn't want to use any synthesizers, you know, techno loops, arpeggios, things like that. Any effect that I wanted to create that would give that impression, I had to figure out a way to do acoustically and orchestrally. So I did take some time and listen to a bunch of episodes from the first season of Mission Impossible. You know, I rewatched those episodes. And I had seen 1, 2, 3, and 4 of the films. But I sort of decided when I got the job that I wouldn't go back and look at those during the process of scoring the film. Mostly because I just didn't want to infringe on what they had done out of respect to them, as well as sort of to give myself as clean a slate as possible. The influence I allowed was whatever Lalo did early on in the TV show. And in fact, McQuarrie once said to me something along the lines of, don't think of this as like a sequel to Mission 4. This is really a follow-up to the TV show. And in combination with Tom's, you know, enthusiasm for a retro score, this seemed like a good match and the way to go. And in fact, the film itself turned out to be much more akin to the TV show than perhaps some of the other feature films that they've done in the series. The first two albums I ever bought, you know, on vinyl when I was a little kid were Magical Mystery Tour and the soundtrack to Superman. So even from a very young age, I was very much into orchestral, symphonic, film scoring, film music, very much in the old style. And I've been waiting a long time for an opportunity to score a movie in that style and to be able to do it with a live orchestra. In this case, it was members of the London orchestras, London Symphony, London Philharmonic. It was a contracted orchestra put together specially for the film. And we got to record at Abbey Road. And that was just an experience that I felt like my whole life had been heading towards in a good way. In order to have a workspace in London, I didn't want to ship my tower over, but I wanted to be able to use my system that I was familiar with. And I'm probably the only composer, I'm definitely the only composer I know who uses Sonar by Cakewalk in the PC environment. And I work in Sonar, and then my main workhorse for all of my sounds is the Vienna Symphonic Library. So I needed to get a laptop that could run Sonar and as much VSL as I could cram into it in order to do all of my writing. The other thing I do that might be a little unusual is I divide the workload between two machines. I have one machine that does all the MIDI and sampled instruments, and I have another machine that's dedicated solely to video playback. So I have Pro Tools with the video and mixes, reference mixes that I make. That's all loaded into the a MacBook that handles all the video and all that stuff. And that keeps the processing power in Cakewalk to a minimum. The other nice thing about that is I can do each cue as a separate piece, and they don't have to start at like bar 4,000 when I'm an hour into the movie. You know what I mean? Everything can still start at like bar 9. I've got my key switches mapped out, and I keep my key switches consistent so that the orchestrators know what does what, and I make a table for them that I send to the orchestrators. And I've just got everything laid out. The ones that I use most often just come up every time I load a blank session. For me, the most important thing is to be able to get to work quickly and to get ideas down as quickly as possible. For example, the very opening of the film, we were having a show and tell with the director. Chris and I were going to look at cues together. And as he came in, he said, I had a thought that maybe the opening of the film should be like this one cue that's later in the film. And so he wanted me to mock that up for him right then and there. And so in 45 minutes, I had to do the opening of the movie for him, you know, the bit with all the logos, the studio logos that leads into the opening shot of the film. So to be able to work quickly and to know where everything is intuitively was very important. So consistent template that's well laid out helps with that a lot. An interesting side note on mission specifically is that all of my work was done using the special edition libraries from Vienna. So it was special edition 1, 2, 3, and 4 and all the extended versions of those. And that gives me, at a really good price, very strong arsenal of articulations and sound that cover pretty much every situation I need to create a convincing mock-up. So it's economic financially, it's economic in terms of system overload or system capacity, but it's also really comprehensive. So what you'll see here is my Sonar template. I've got the instruments laid out in their tracks. If I go over to Vienna, you can see the layout that I've got here. So, you know, my winds, I stem everything out into submixes, I bus it, winds, brass, percussion, piano, which includes my harp and any synth elements. In this case, there weren't any, but in another film I might need that. And then my strings. And you can see the individual instrument tracks here, flute, piccolo, oboe, English horn. And we look at the flute, for example, and I've got a matrix built with legato, staccato, and then I think this is alto flute here, because I did sometimes use alto flute. Yeah, alto flute, legato, sus. I use the sus ones generally when I'm doing my mock-ups because I try to think of the breathing in the phrasing that I write it, but sometimes when I want sustains, I don't want to have to re-articulate the note, and if you don't use the sus samples, obviously the sample will cut off. In this particular template that I built, I have two instances of Vienna Ensemble running. The reason for that is that I'm using actually Sonar 8, which uses the VST profile 2, I believe, not VST 3. So you can't do more than 16 MIDI channels for each VST instance. So in this second one, I've got my celeste, my horns, trumpet, trombone, and tuba. And I tend to try to divide things up between the instances. Then I've got my percussion here. And in the case of this specific cue that we're going to look at, I also have a live percussion piece that was built. I had it built by the live percussionists during an earlier recording session. And so you see here, this is an actual audio file of the percussion. So I'll play a little bit of my mock-up for you now. The one thing to remember is that because I knew that this piece was going to be performed live and wasn't going to be featuring any of the samples, I did not spend any time at all worrying about how real it sounded. So this is literally just me getting the idea down as quickly as possible using the sounds out of the box. And I'm very happy with the results. So it doesn't take a lot of work and articulation to get a performance that's very close to a believable live performance.